Welcome back, young scholars. In this video, we'll be discussing the Chinese revolutions and how communism played out in China in the 20th century. The big questions you should be able to answer after watching this video are: how did the communists rise to power in China? And how did Mao implement Marx's theory of communism in China? So how did the communists rise to power in China? First, we have to understand the context. China in the 19th century was a bit of a hot mess. In the 1800s, the Qing dynasty had experienced both internal issues in the form of peasant revolts like the Taiping Rebellion, which was a rebellion started by a guy claiming to be Jesus' brother, who was seeking greater equity in China. There was also widespread famine because China had failed to industrialize and yet had this massive growing population. There were external problems in the form of the defeat to the British and the Opium Wars. There were spheres of influence that had been carved out across China by various industrial powers like the British, the Germans, the French, the Japanese, the Russians. Now, China attempted to reform through a series of policies known as self-strengthening. But self-strengthening ultimately failed. And the reason it failed is because China is a very traditional conservative society and culture. Now in 1908, to compound problems, China was ruled by a three-year-old emperor. Now there was really a regent who would have been in power making decisions. But as you can imagine, three-year-old running all of China, not the best idea. So in 1911, another rebellion breaks out in China. This is the second in just one decade because there was a previous rebellion, the Boxer Rebellion in 1898. And this ends the long reign of dynasties, this 3,000-year-old dynasty system that had been established. And a more Western-style republic is put into place. Now, this republic is relatively weak. It's kind of equivalent to the Articles of Confederation in U.S. history, where the centralized government didn't have a lot of power. So ultimately, these regional warlords, these sort of provinces, localized provinces, had more of the power, and they were competing and fighting with one another for power. So there are two political parties that emerge that are seeking to reunify China, and those are the Kuomintang, or the KMT. Kuomintang is pronounced Kuomintang sometimes, and so the KMT are the initials for it. And then the Chinese Communist Party, the CCP. Now, the Kuomintang was founded by a guy named Sun Yat-sen, and the Kuomintang was a nationalist party. So, much like the Boxers, the nationalists wanted to end any type of foreign intervention in China. They were not happy with these spheres of influence that foreign powers had carved out, and they wanted to make China great again by building up the strength of the Chinese from within. The CCP, or the Chinese Communist Party, was led by Mao Zedong. It was founded in 1921. The Chinese Communist Party sought to address the other major issue in China besides foreign intervention, and that was that China was a society where there was vast inequality, vast gaps between the wealthy landholders and the poor peasants. So don't get confused, Mao's steely-eyed glance there, that's young Mao, with the laughing Mao. Oh yes, laughing Mao. So after Sun Yat-sen died, a civil war breaks out in China between the Kuomintang, this time led by a guy named Chiang Kai-shek, and the Chinese Communist Party, the CCP. The Kuomintang prevail, the CCP are defeated, but this is kind of a blessing in disguise for the CCP because they are forced to retreat to the more rural parts of China. And this is where the CCP gains their base of support and strength. So the CCP and Mao Zedong gain a following amongst these rural peasants, and this is going to become important to understand some of the distinctions between the way communism was implemented in China versus, let's say, the Soviet Union. Now in 1934, there's this sort of mythology that has been built up around Mao Zedong and the Chinese Communist Party, because the Kuomintang had the CCP leaders kind of pinned down in southern China, and it's at this time that the CCP leaders, led by Mao Zedong, go on this nearly 6,000-mile-long march across the more rural parts of China, including these great snowy mountains. And so it leads to this perception that Mao Zedong is somehow this superhuman, that he's capable of amazing great feats, in the same way that sometimes mythology has been built up around George Washington with stories like, you know, the fact that he cut down this cherry tree and then couldn't tell a lie. The reality was that Mao Zedong actually rode a donkey for much of this 6,000-mile journey, while many of the other members of the CCP were walking. 1937, the Japanese invade China. This is this brutal invasion that involves the rape of Nanjing. And the Kuomintang have power at the time, and they do not do a very good job of fighting these Japanese invading forces. In fact, many of the Chinese perceive them as spending more of their time focusing on trying to defeat the CCP than these invading Japanese. Meanwhile, the CCP were far more successful in the more rural parts of China in preventing and stopping this Japanese invasion. With the end of World War II in 1945 and the defeat of the Japanese and the Japanese retreat from China, we're going to see in 4 years later, in 1949, the Chinese Communist Party rise to power. There is another revolution, a second revolution in the 20th century in China in 1949, and the CCP takes power, with the support of the peasants. Now, the Kuomintang is forced to flee to Taiwan, where they're going to establish their own state, and that state is referred to as the Republic of China, not to be confused with the People's Republic of China. So essentially, there are two Chinas. One of them is what I call Big China, the People's Republic of China, which is controlled by the Communist Party of China. The other is the Little China, which is just this tiny island controlled currently by the descendants of the Kuomintang, this nationalist party. So it can be sometimes very easy to confuse the two. But for purposes of U.S. policy, we technically only recognize Big China. It's called the One China policy. Because when we do recognize Little China, Big China gets mad at us. How did Mao implement Marxist theory of communism in China? First, Mao faced this significant challenge. He needed to make socialism a reality in a nation with this huge population, right? So when you think about socialism, it's about trying to figure out a way to divide up the pie that is all goods and resources within a society. And when you have a huge population, the size of the individual slices of that pie become very, very, very small. Now, also in China, there was not really a significant industrial base in the 1940s when Mao took power. China had failed in their efforts at self-strengthening, and so China was even less industrialized than the Soviet Union in 1917 when they experienced their communist revolution. The one thing Mao had going for him is that he had the backing of the Chinese peasants. But this is not how Karl Marx had originally envisioned communism working, right? Karl Marx envisioned communist revolutions led by the proletariat, these factory workers. But in China, there really weren't significant factories in 1949. So Mao decides that he is going to use the rural peasants as a sort of backbone and base for his communist revolution. Mao has the benefit of having the Soviet blueprint. And so what Mao does is he looks to Stalin's ideas, and in particular, he looks at the five-year plan, which the Soviets had developed, as a way of accelerating both their industrial capacity, but also their agricultural output. So Mao is going to copy the Soviet five-year plan, which is a focus on heavy industry, but less focused on consumer goods. So in China, they start building up their railroads and their tanks and their tractors and their telephone wires and their state-run factories. And so this is one of the major similarities between the way communism was implemented in both the Soviet Union and China. Now, in both the Soviet Union and China, there's also this attempt to collectivize farms, to take privately owned smaller farms and to turn them into state-run communes, large enterprises run by the state. And you can see in images like this, this is not necessarily the most efficient system for farming. You can see there's just too many farmers, frankly, in this field to really be that efficient when it comes to the way in which some of these communes were producing food. But the peasants in China loved Mao. They fully backed anything that Mao told them to do. And this is a significant difference between what we saw in the Soviet Union and what we saw in China. In the Soviet Union, there was significant pushback by both the wealthy farmers and also even some of those poor farmers who had just emerged from serfdom. Many of the farmers in the Soviet Union, in resistance to turning over their farmland, had destroyed crops, had killed some of their livestock, and that just wasn't the case in China. There was far more support for Mao's ideas and this concept of collectivization. Like in the Soviet Union, women in communist China were afforded certainly greater rights and opportunities. And this was especially seen through the propaganda that was produced by the Chinese government. You often see women engaged in what up to that point were sort of non-traditional roles for women. For example, images of women welding or doing other productive activities outside of their home. And this represents a significant shift, right, in gender roles in China. Remember, in China, this is a Confucian society where the patriarchy is very strong because women are playing this role of the inferior in this relationship with their husband, and as a result they need to be obedient and respectful. We're ultimately going to see China progress relatively slowly when it comes to changes in gender roles. So while the propaganda may have been presenting a picture that women in China were taking on far greater responsibilities outside the home, the data from China from this period maybe presents a different picture that suggests that ultimately social change was coming relatively slowly in China. Once Mao had implemented the first five-year plan, after the results of that first five-year plan, he was recognizing that there was this growing disparity or gap between the urban factory workers and the rural peasants that were the base for his support. And Mao was concerned that there was this inequality that needed to be addressed. What Mao does is he creates a series of policies known as the Great Leap Forward from 1958 to 1960. And he promotes small-scale industrialization to be brought to the rural parts of China. He develops these communes, these collectivized farms in the rural parts of China. But on the communes, you also will see images showing industry, or what are attempts at industry, these backyard furnaces which were designed to build steel. Now what the Chinese did was they started tossing all of their scrap metal from their various tools, their bed frames, their woks, into these backyard furnaces with the goal of producing higher quality steel. What they ended up with was really just a bunch of crap, useless steel. So this was a terrible failure because it also diverts resources from the rural parts of China, which are producing food, to produce this steel that ultimately becomes worthless. Mao also has these sort of crazy ideas about waging war against the sparrow, a bird. And for 3 days, the Chinese go out and they make all kinds of noise. And as a result, many of these sparrows die of anxiety. And the thinking was the sparrows would eat the wheat crop, which they did, but the sparrows were also very useful to the Chinese ecosystem because the sparrows also ate bugs, and once the sparrows weren't there, you had this outbreak of locust in the next growing season, which still destroyed a lot of the crops. These were really bad ideas. They created, though, these propaganda images showing children literally standing on top of fields of grain that were so closely grown, but in reality, these were just photoshopped images to try and persuade people that these policies of Mao Zedong were successful. But ultimately, the Great Leap Forward was an epic failure. 30 million Chinese people died of starvation. That is just an incredibly massive number. That's sort of on the same scale as the Great Dying, which resulted from the Columbian Exchange and the bringing over of diseases from the Old World to the New World. If you were an opponent of Mao Zedong, if you were raising concerns about the policies that he was putting forth, those opponents were oftentimes rounded up, they were killed, they were sent to re-education camps where they were taught to value and appreciate Mao Zedong even more. And we see that sort of repression taking place in many of these socialist states, including the Soviet Union. So as time passes and we move into the 1960s, Mao has this perception that China is moving further away from their goals of achieving a communist state. And so Mao decides that he needs to try and recommit China to the principles of socialism. So from 1966 to 1976, Mao attempts to recapture the goals of communism and ultimately to crush capitalist thought and Western thought and democratic thought, which Mao believed was starting to seep into the Chinese state. What Mao does is he identifies the group that is most impressionable to lead this revolutionary moment in Chinese history, and that would be young people, middle schoolers, high schoolers, and Mao recruits them for these groups called the Red Guards. And the Red Guards wear these sashes and they would sort of travel around China of Mao. And they would have their little red books, which were books containing quotes of Mao Zedong. They were on the lookout for people holding these sort of old ideas or these Western democratic ideas. And oftentimes girls were involved. And so we see again this sort of evidence of this changing gender roles for women in China. Now the Red Guards would oftentimes very publicly identify people that they believed of holding these old ideas. They would publicly torture them, beat them. Again, young people can sometimes get very excited and sometimes too excited by an idea. In this case, the sort of commitment to reinvigorating socialist goals and values within Chinese society was something that maybe went a little bit too extreme of a direction. Why would the people continue to follow Mao Zedong despite the failures of the Great Leap Forward and despite some of the problems associated with the Cultural Revolution? Well, it was probably because Mao was a master of propaganda. He was oftentimes depicted in images sort of hanging out as a man of the people amongst the Chinese peasants, or maybe at a younger age, sort of this Jesus-like figure walking on the various mountaintops in China. Now, there are other world leaders in the 20th century that were good at this, whether they be Stalin or even modern day, Kim Jong-un creates these images that are sort of larger than life of himself. Putin is a master of this, showing images of himself riding bare-chested or petting tigers. And this is known as the cult of personality. So cult of personality is when a leader uses the media, propaganda, to create heroic images of himself. Mao did this. He would do things like go out for a swim in the Yangtze River, and he would have it reported in the Chinese state media that, you know, he swam this ridiculous distance and that he did it in essentially world record time, when in actuality, you know, the photographs of Mao just show him floating in the river. That's this concept of the cult of personality, and it's not new. We've been talking about this concept of leaders using propaganda all the way back to like the very first rulers in world history. Towards the end of the Cultural Revolution, Mao becomes a little bit upset with the Soviet Union. And so in order to make the Soviets jealous, one of the things Mao does is he meets with the United States and Richard Nixon. And the background for this is that the United States and the Communist Chinese had begun diplomatic relations by playing the game of ping pong together. There was ping pong diplomacy, which established relations between the United States and Chinese again. Mao dies in 1976, and following his death, we see this dramatic shift in the Chinese economy. So Mao was attempting to achieve the goals of a more equitable society by nationalizing the means of production. But following his death in 1976, China takes a different tact. They move in the direction of a more free market capitalist economy. They give up that dream or vision of creating a communist society, despite the fact that China still is communist because there's only one political party, and that's the Chinese Communist Party. These economic reforms were led by the leader of the Chinese Communist Party following Mao Zedong, and that was a guy named Deng Xiaoping. And Deng Xiaoping and his economic reforms have been pretty wildly successful, right? Think of all the goods today that are produced in China. And we can see this in graphs like this, which show the relative GDP of various modern industrialized nations. And GDP is a measure of all the goods and services produced in a particular country in a given year. Here we have in 2010, the United States and China. Here we see the other major powers of the world, Japan, Germany, France, Brazil, Great Britain, and India. Now projected out into 2025, we see the United States, and here we see some projections of China starting to surpass the United States in terms of their total gross domestic product. Now, again, that doesn't take into consideration gross domestic product per capita per person, but it does suggest that the Chinese economy is growing very rapidly. We project this out into 2050, and we see the United States, and then we see China and the various other industrializing nations, including India, which has a very rapidly growing population and is beginning this process of starting to catch up with some of their industrial output. China, in the last 5 years, has also been involved in a project that I want you to be aware of called the Belt and Road Initiative. And what the Belt and Road Initiative involves is trying to rebuild some of these trade networks, the Silk Road, the Indian Ocean sea lanes. And they're doing this by supporting infrastructure projects, the building of railroads, the building of ports, the building of bridges, and various other countries besides China that are maybe a little bit struggling more economically. Now, why is China doing this? China is looking back at their past and finding the formulas of success in the past. One of the ways in which China has been successful was by dominating both regional and global trade. China is recognizing that this is the way it becomes an economic leader in the world. China, however, has a number of other issues that it will have to confront in the 21st century. The communist government is very controlling. A good example of this, in 1989, there were some students at Beijing University that wanted to protest the fact that the Chinese communist government was not very democratic. They didn't allow a lot of opposition. So they took to the streets in protest. In response, the Chinese government sent some tanks out and the Chinese army to quash this protest. And this led to this famous scene, which you may have seen, of a man essentially squaring up to a line of tanks. That man was eventually captured, and we don't know very much about him because he essentially disappears. The protesters eventually are fired upon by the military. This leads to a number of protesters dying. And this occurred in 1989. It's known as the Tiananmen Square Massacre. As a result of this, people are certainly more reluctant in China to go out and actively protest against the government because they're fearful of what the Chinese government might do to them. And so what we see in China is this growing government censorship of the media and of free speech. We see this in a number of other ways as well. In China, there are restrictions on people's ability to just simply go on to the internet and search on Google. There is no Google in China. There are government search engines that have all kinds of filters placed on them that limits people's opportunity to be able to access information about topics like Tiananmen Square Massacre or 1989. There are also websites that are blocked or restricted. So for example, you can't simply get on Facebook in China. There's a Chinese equivalent of Facebook that is essentially run by the government and that has all sorts of oversight, which doesn't exist in the United States. A third problem that China is potentially going to face in the 21st century has to do with their birth rate and death rate. So you can see in this graph here, this sort of spike in the 1960s in the death rate that was caused by the failure of the Great Leap Forward and 30 million Chinese people dying of starvation. We also see since really the 1970s, a dramatic decline in the birth rate of China, and that's due to the one-child policy. Now, the one-child policy has been lifted in the last 5 years or so, but this is going to lead to all kinds of demographic problems for China because the distribution of their population by age is not one that's a very healthy one for any given society. You want to see more of a pyramid here because you want the base of any society to be the young, kind of healthy, strong people who are contributing the work necessary to sort of sustain and maintain a society. Here you're going to see China's elderly population very soon exceeding almost the sort of number of people that are young in China, and that's going to be a real drain on Chinese resources. So as a result of watching this video, you should be able to answer these two big questions. First, how did Mao implement Marx's theory of communism in China? And second, will the 21st century be dominated by China? Thanks for watching.